How's everybody doing today? Yeah, we all great? It's nice to see you. Let's all begin with standing, and we'll begin the worship service this morning to the Lord, joining together our voices, praising the Lord's name this morning. It's been a while since we've done this one. If you feel the urge, it's a good clapping one.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away.
Listening to you guys sing, it's always such a pleasure for us up here. So let's continue to worship.
Water, you turn into wine. You open the eyes of the blind. There's no thank you. our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, who could stand against? If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God, our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. To grace a greater death.
that last verse one more time. Oh, to grace.
Oh, to grace. How great a debtor. Daily I am constrained to be. Let that grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts unbound. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts unbound.
You guys can all have a seat.
Thank you. try to hide. Exposed beyond the shadows, you take the cup from me. Your dirt removes my blindness, your pain becomes my peace. If I was not so weak, if I was not so cold, if I was not so scared of being broken, growing old, I would be, I would be, I would be, I would be.
Right, let's all continue to worship together. Let's make our way back to our seats. Let's all stand together and we'll continue to praise the Lord this morning. Thank you.
many to count. To say that I love you, and to worship you now. 'Cause your love is perfect, your heart is kind. I'm yours forever, forever you're mine. Jesus, the anthem of my heart. Jesus, the anchor of my soul. I'm overwhelmed by all you are. Oh, how I love you. Jesus, the anthem. Jesus, the anthem of my heart. Jesus, the anchor of my soul. I'm overwhelmed by all you are. Oh, how I love you. Jesus, the anthem of my heart. Jesus, the anchor of my soul.
Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to just come before you and worship. We recognize, as we just sang, that you are holy, Lord, and we just want to glorify you, Lord. We know that you and you alone are worthy of our worship and our praises, and as we get into your word now, we just pray for the work of your Holy Spirit to bring understanding and application, Lord, to our lives. Empower us, Lord, to live lives worthy of your name, Lord. We love you so much, and thank you again for this time that we have together and just lift up your name in praise, and we just give you the rest of this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, we'd like to dismiss the children for Children's Church. As a reminder, they are meeting in the classrooms over here on this side of the building, so if you got kiddos that are going to head to Sunday school, you can go on ahead and make your way out there to drop them off at their classrooms.
Good morning. Welcome you to open your Bibles with me to 1 John chapter 2. So we got a spring teaser last couple days, right? That's what it's called. And then I saw that it's supposed to get, like, maybe even snow next week. So whenever I get depressed about the weather, though, I like that show, Life Below Zero, and you see those people up in Alaska. And they have two seasons. It's called Cut Firewood and Burn Firewood. Those are the two seasons. And I feel better, right? So there's an old Peanuts cartoon, and we find Linus in that cartoon, and he's protesting, and he says, "I love mankind. It's people I can't stand." Love in an abstract way is easy, right? It's loving in the flesh that becomes difficult. The flow of this letter so far, as we've been walking through it, that God is light, John had told us, that there's no darkness in him. He's holy, he's pure, right? And his light will expose the darkness, right? And that's important because the darkness keeps you out of fellowship with God. And it's John's desire, his great desire there in chapter 1, that you walk in fellowship with him and walk in fellowship with the body. And so he says, "So I write these things to you," he tells us in chapter 1, "so that you may not sin," right? That you may not walk in that darkness, so that you can have fellowship with God. But if you do sin, God will forgive your sins if you confess them, because we have Christ, who is our advocate to the Father, right? And then he begins to tell us what this walking in light looks like, right? What this fellowship with God looks like. And last week we saw it looks like obedience. It looks like obeying his commandments. It looks like keeping his word, right? It looks like walking in the manner that Jesus walked. And we saw that last week. And we weren't talking perfection. We were talking diligence, desire, effort there. So it looks like Jesus' life. And it's found in his words. And the most important being, love your brother, love your neighbor as yourself. And we're going to look at that this morning. That's where our text brings us here this morning. Look at 1 John 2, chapter 2, verses 7 through 11. Read along with me here this morning. "Beloved, I am not writing a new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you have heard. On the other hand, I am writing a new commandment to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. The one who says he is in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. The one who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But the one who hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes." And so John begins here in this section with the greeting, "Beloved." It's a favorite greeting of John. John is known as the apostle of love. He'll use this greeting 6 times in 1 John alone, another 4 times in 3 John. And he writes about the love of God, the love of the brethren, more than any other apostle. As you look at his writings. And so as he introduces this subject to his people, he calls him out as the beloved. And then he says here, "I am not writing a new commandment to you, but an old commandment which you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is a word which you have heard." Now, he doesn't mention the commandment there in verse 7, but when we get to verse 9 and 10, we find he's talking about the commandment to love, right? And specifically to love the brethren. And when what John does here is introduce a reality of the Christian life that he will reinforce over and over again in his letter as we go through this letter. And that is, the Christian life will be marked by really 2 evidence, right? It'll be marked by obedience to God and the love of the brothers and love of God. These 2 evidence of a changed life, John will repeat over and over again for us. You're going to obey God and you're going to love other Christians. It's a theme throughout his letter. For example, in chapter 3, verse 10, he says, "By this the children of God and the children of the devil are obvious. Anyone who does not practice righteousness," that's obedience, "is not of God, nor the one who does not love his brother." In chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, he says, "Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and whoever loves the Father loves the children born of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and observe," he says, "observe his commandments." And so there he repeats them both again oppositely. In John's second letter, he writes in 2 John 1:6, he says, "And this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. This is the commandment, just as if you heard from the beginning, that you should walk in it." And so John continually links this idea, right, of loving and obeying God. Of loving and obeying God. And not just loving, but loving the brethren, loving those who are in Christ Jesus. And John says there in chapter 2, verse 7, this is not a new commandment, right? I'm not writing a new commandment. The Greek literally reads here, "No new commandment I'm writing to you," which puts the emphasis on this "no new commandment." This is not new. He wants you to know it's not new, right? And John says, "I'm not telling you something new, but something old enough that," he says here, "you've heard from the beginning." You've heard it from the beginning, he says. The commandment is not new. It is an old commandment. And it's old in two ways. First, it goes all the way back to their experience as a chosen race, Israel. It goes all the way back to the Old Testament. The law of love, which God established, right, through Moses. This commandment goes back to Moses and the law. In Leviticus 19, 18, listen to what it says here. In Leviticus 17, 19, verse 17, "You shall not hate your fellow countrymen in your heart. You may surely reprove your neighbor, but shall not incur sin against him. You shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." And back in Deuteronomy 6, Moses gives Israel the commandments. And in Deuteronomy 6, 5, it demanded that God be loved with what? With all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Jesus, later on when he's on earth, he identifies that as the greatest commandment. And then he said, the second is like it, right? Love your neighbor as yourself. So in that sense, the command had been with God's people for over 1,400 years. And so he said, when he says it's not a new commandment, it's a 1,400-year-old commandment, right? But he builds on that idea. John builds on the idea that it's not a new commandment. And Paul builds on it in Romans 13 with a familiar portion of Scripture, because it links to the Old Testament. And he says in Romans 13, 8, "Owe nothing to anyone," he says, "except to love one another. For he who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the law." Has fulfilled the law. And how so, when you think about it? How does it fulfill the law? The law can be divided actually into two sections. All of the law that God gave them can be put under two headings. One is loving God, right? One is loving God. When you don't make idols, you're loving God. When you're not taking his name in vain, when you're not having other gods, you're loving God. And the second half has to do with human relationships, has to do with loving your neighbor. And if you love your neighbor, you're not going to murder, you're not going to steal, you're not going to covet, you're not going to lie. All those things that have to do with a direct relationship to other people. And so in that way, this commandment fulfills all the law. Fulfills all the law. And so this wasn't anything new, that God wanted them to love their neighbors, that God wanted them to love those around them, right? But John says in 2:8, the commandment are also new. He's like, it's not an old commandment, but he's saying, but it's also new, right? It's a new commandment. And that Jesus has issued it anew. Look, in John 13, 34, look what Jesus says here. He says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Right? Now, you heard it before, but here's the new. Here's the new part. Even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Now, look what John says. He says it this way. He says the same thing, but he says it this way in verse 8 here in 1 John 2. He says, on the other hand, I am writing a new commandment to you. And look what he says, which is true in him. The first thing that we need to notice is that the new commandment to you, which is true in him, the newness of this commandment is that it has become true in Christ. The newness of it is that this commandment to love has been manifested in the person of Christ, and that has never happened before, right? It has not. Never before, even though it was very, very well known that God commanded the Jews that they love, right? That there was a love requirement of the law, that if you love, you weren't going to violate those commands, which are, right, then acts of hatred if you don't. And even though that was clear in Scripture, never has that love been so clearly manifested and so clearly seen as in the perfection of Jesus Christ. That's what's new about it. So that's the point of the statement, which he says, which is true in him. That's the idea behind when Jesus says, a new commandment I give to you, the love of one another. And he says it's important, right? Why? Because as I have loved you, as I have loved you. That's the point of the statement. So never has the world seen the perfect love until Jesus shows it to them. So newness isn't in the fundamental command. The newness is in the manifestation of the perfect glory of Jesus Christ that we've seen on this earth. That's the newness. In the upper room on the night that Christ was betrayed, Jesus demonstrates this great love. You remember that? He takes a towel and a basin of water and he washes the disciples' feet. And in John 13, it says this. It says, Jesus said to them, you call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so am I. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example that you also should do as I did to you. Christ, what he was doing always was giving the example of love, right? The greatest commandment. He was not instituting a ceremonial foot washing by which we all show up at church with clean feet and wash each other's feet, right? That's not what he was doing. He was saying something much more difficult to practice, that we who follow him, we who call him master and teacher, right, must set aside our rights, ourself, and serve one another to this extent, right, out of love. In the same chapter in John 13, in verse 34, he says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. And then he says, by this all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. The qualifier again, as I have loved you, right? As I have loved you. So in what way is the command new? It's new in the manifestation of its perfect glory in the person of Jesus Christ. In that way, it is new. Before Christ, all man could do was do the best he could do. He didn't have a perfect example of that love. But after Christ, we have a perfect example. We have a pinnacle to reach and go after. Now, let me suggest a few ways that this manifestation of this perfect glory of love through Jesus Christ, right, how it plays out. First, it plays out in emphasis, and that is in that Jesus brought it together with the command to love God. You see, as being the completion, the keeping of the entire law. Before Christ, we didn't hear that. We didn't know that, right? So Christ brings it in a new way and telling us, look, Loving God and loving your neighbor fulfills all the law. It's the heading. It fulfills the law. Secondly, it's new in its extent. In the parable of the Good Samaritan, Jesus extends the definition of the neighbor. As I read Leviticus, Jesus was telling them in Deuteronomy, he's talking specifically the neighbor being fellow Jews, but Jesus, in the parable of the Good Samaritan, he extends that definition of neighbor to go beyond race and beyond religion, doesn't he? Beyond that. Thirdly, it's new in its quality, in that his own self-sacrifice on the cross became the standard of that love. And then it was new in disciples' continuing apprehension of it, and that is that the love of Jesus on the cross is inexhaustible. We can never plumb its depth. We can never know it completely, right? And so as we grow in understanding of that great love, we will grow in our apprehension of how we must love one another, right? And finally, it's new in one other way, and John goes on to say it this way in verse 8. Look, go back to our text. He says, a new commandment to you, I give to you, which is true in him. And then he says, and in you. And in you. Not only is there a newness to it because of the manifestation in Christ, but there's a newness to this love. There's a freshness to this love because now it is manifested in you if you are his disciple, if he is your Lord and Master. The manifestation of our love is something new, something incredibly wonderful. And it's because we're a new creation, a new man. We are in Christ. Or as John has already said, we are abiding in him. And Jesus said it that same night in the upper room. He said, I'm going to send to you the Holy Spirit. And he's going to come and he's going to be with you. And he says, and he will be in you. He will abide in you. He's going to come and take residence up in you. And in John 14, this is what he said in verse 16, I will ask the Father and he will give to you another helper that he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not see him or know him. But you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. He says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. And after a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live. You will live also. In verse 20, in that day you will know that I am in the Father and you in me and I in you. How will I know? How will you know? What will be the evidence of this Holy Spirit abiding in me? Look at verse 21. He who has my commandments and keeps them, that's the first observance, right? Is the one who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father and will love him and will disclose myself to him. The second is love, 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 love. You see, the Holy Spirit comes and he takes residence in you, and you will be then wrapped up in two things: obeying the commandments of God and loving the Father, loving Jesus, loving one another, right? And in a term, being loved by here Jesus and the Father. So the Holy Spirit takes up that residence in your life, and the fruit of the Spirit, according to Galatians 5:22, the first fruit of the Spirit is what? It is love. Romans 5:5 says the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts. And so the picture looks like this, and this is what John is talking about when he says, and in you. And the picture is this, is that love is exemplified in Jesus. It is testified and empowered then through his Holy Spirit, right, which abides in us. And we then now have the power to love like Christ. That's what it looks like. We have the power now to give that love to others. And that way it is new. It is very new, right? Very new. And look what John says. All this is happening because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. The Apostle Paul put it this way in Ephesians. He said in Ephesians 5:8, "For you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children as light." To the Corinthians, Paul put it this way in 2 Corinthians 4:6, "For God who said, 'Light shall shine out of the darkness,' is the one who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ." You see, and so what Paul is saying and what John is saying is this, that you have the capability to give that light because the light is already shown. And how is he shown? Well, he came to earth and he died on the cross. He's shown the love of God in a mighty way. And he's now shown in your own heart, right? And you're being transformed into that light. Yet at the same time, there's a process involved in that, isn't there? It takes time. The darkness doesn't dissipate instantly, but rather it's a gradually dispelled as the true light of Jesus Christ and God's word shines more and more and more in your life, in your heart, in your mind, right? And this is why John started with the fellowship with God and the forgiveness of sin. Light is already shining. And the light came into the world, and Jesus said, "I'm the light of the world." It shines in Christ. It shines in the gospel. It shines in his world. And it shines in you. It shines in you if you are in him. So this new capacity to love, this fresh dimension of love, this experience of love, this deposit of love in your life is possible and real because the light has already been shining. That's what John is saying. And it is shining in you. It shines in you. And it will be fulfilled in the coming day at the end of time, right? And in that day, all the darkness is cast away. And that will not only be true in this world, but it'll be true in you who are believers. And so naturally, verse 9 then makes sense. Look at verse 9. The one who says, that's a profession, right? The one who says he is in the light and yet hates his brother is in darkness until now. The one who says he is in the light and hates his brother, well, that just can't possibly be, right? He's in darkness until now. And here's the reality. If you hate your brother, right, then he says you're in darkness until now. And it's a tough statement. It means that he hasn't come out of darkness. Some take that to mean that they're not a believer, and others take that to mean that they're not walking in the light and need to repent. One thing is definitely true, and that is this. And that is that you can't walk in the light and darkness at the same time. The evidence of walking in the light is loving Christ, and loving as Christ loved. And you can't do that while walking in darkness. Now, what does he mean by hate? He says, he who hates his brother. Webster, the dictionary tells us that hate is a feeling of extreme hostility or extreme dislike of another. That's a good definition. We know the feeling of dislike, right? The aversion to someone, a sense of extreme hostility towards another. But that can be expressed in two ways, in two different ways. It can be active in that we indulge in malicious talk or in actions towards others. We can strike them or beat them or throw garbage over their fence, right? Or mistreat them in some way. We can attack them. We can slander them behind their back. All these are active expressions of hate. And perhaps most of us think of hate only in that sense. But hate can also be expressed passively, and it's still hate. It can be expressed by indifference, by coldness, by isolation, by exclusion, by unconcern for others. So hate can be expressed in both those ways. But I need to maybe define love also. And especially what love is not, right? Culturally, love, if you mention love in our world, culturally, people think of love as niceness, being nice to someone, right? Right? They picture a loving person as always being nice and sweet towards everyone. He would never confront sin because that's not loving. He never gets angry about evil or says anything that might upset someone, right? Because that's not loving. But if you're all familiar with the four Gospels, you immediately see that the cultural definition of love would mean that Jesus was not a loving man, right? Jesus loved the Jewish religious leaders when he said to them, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, you hypocrites." He loved Peter when he said to him, "Get behind me, Satan." He loved the multitude when he said to them, "You unbelieving and perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you?" The Apostle Paul was filled with the Holy Spirit, right? Who's the first fruit is love, when he said to Elymas, "Who are you who are full of deceit and a fraud? You the son of the devil," he called him. "You enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease to make crooked the straight ways of the Lord?" And then what did Paul do? He struck him blind. Now, I'm not saying that we should go around blasting people while claiming that we're loving them. I'm only pointing out that our definition of love, in a particular sense, right, must encompass all that the Bible says about love, about love. The speaker that we have coming here, the 1st of March, to speak about the ideology of wokeness and its, you know, where it doesn't fit in the biblical realm of truth, right? If you go online and you search, you'll have a video where he hammers on people who say, "Oh, it's loving. It's a loving just to call someone who's a he who wants to claim they're a she to call them a she. That's a loving thing." But biblically, we find that that's not the loving thing. The loving thing is to point them out of fallacies and into truth. And into truth. Love, really, biblically, can be defined with one word, and that is selflessness, right? And it's exemplified by Christ, who emptied himself, as Scripture says, and took on the form of man and to the point of death, right? So John says in verse 10 here now, as we go back to our Scripture, "The one who loves his brother, though, abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him." And again, that's logical. On the other flip side, well, then the one that loves the brother abides in the light, right? And there's no cause for stumbling in him. If you're walking in the light, well, just in a practical sense, you're not going to stumble, right? If you got that flashlight, you're not going to stumble. And in the context, stumbling would be a way of expressing sinning against others, not loving, right? If you love people, you don't sin against them. And even though we don't perfectly do that, we feel terrible remorse when we fail to love the way that Jesus has called us to love, don't we? So the contrast is pretty clear. John says if you're a true Christian, you're going to love people and you're going to love them the way that Christ loves you, and you're not going to sin against them as a pattern of your life, as the desire of your life. So there's a new commandment to love, attitude, old commandment to love. And then he talks about the life, right, of love. It's outward manifestation through us, the model that Christ has given us. And he closes in verse 11 here with a command on the absence of love. Look at this with me. He says, "But the one who hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he's going because the darkness has blinded his eyes." Now look, what verse 10 and 11 are saying together is this. Love defines whether you're walking in the light or walking in darkness, right? Sacrificial, biblical love that is exemplified by Jesus Christ defines whether you're walking in darkness or walking in the light. That's what he's telling us here. And the model and the standard is Christ, right? I believe that the believer's life is marked by love, or it's not evident at all. All the other things you can do, you can memorize scripture, you can preach, you can do all the mission work you want, and if it's your life is not marked by love, it's not evident at all, not biblically. And let me end with a couple things here. As you fellowship with God and abide in Jesus, there are two evidences of that walk that will be prevalent in your life. They are the desire and yearning to commit to obey his word, and they are to love like Jesus loved. The power to do so comes from the new life in Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit that dwells in you. The love is essential. It's so essential, actually, that every New Testament letter that was written to a church entreats that church, those believers, to love God, love the brethren in some way, shape, or form. Every single letter. I found 310 references to it, to that idea. In Romans 12:10, it says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. In Romans 13:8, owe nothing to anyone except to love one another, for he who loves his neighbor has fulfilled the law. Don't worry, I'm not going to go through all 310. But I'm going to give you one or two from each letter written. In 1 Corinthians 13:1, if I speak with the tongues of men and angels but do not have love, I become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. How about that one? I can remove mountains, but if I don't have love, you're nothing. You have nothing. And if I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned but do not have love, it profits me nothing. I thought feeding the poor was love. That's wrong. Anyone can feed the poor. Right? 1 Corinthians 16:14, let all that you do be done in love. 2 Corinthians 8:24, therefore openly before the churches show them the proof of your love and of our reason for boasting about you. In Galatians 5:13, it says, for you were called to freedom, brethren, only do not turn your freedom into an opportunity for the flesh, but through love, serve one another. Philippians 1:9, and this I pray that your love may abound still more and more in real knowledge and all discernment. In Colossians 1:4, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have for all the saints. You see, for Paul, it wasn't just simply that you made a profession, but the evidence of it was what? The love that you now have for all the saints, for all those people that you used to hate, right? For the Gentiles that the Jews used to hate, and the Jews that the Gentiles used to hate, he says. In 1 Thessalonians 4:9, now as to the love of the brethren, you have no need for anyone to write to you. Why? For you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. How? In the person of Christ. That's how. In 2 Thessalonians 1:3, we ought always to give thanks to God for you, brethren, as only fitting, because your faith is greatly enlarged and the love of each one of you towards one another grows even greater. 1 Timothy 1:5, but the goal of our instruction is love. From a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of timidity, but of power and love and discipline. Titus 3:15, all who are with me greet you. Greet those who love us from the faith. Grace be with all of you. Philippians 1:5, because I hear of your love and of faith which you have towards the Lord Jesus and towards all the saints. Hebrews 6:10, for God is not unjust so as to forget your work and the love which you have shown towards his name and having ministered and is still ministering to the saints. In James 2:8, James says, if however you are fulfilling the royal law according to Scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. He says, you're doing well. You're doing well, he says. 1 Peter 1:22, since you have in obedience to the truth purified your souls for sincere love of the brethren. Fervently love one another from the heart. Man, I thought I purified my soul to serve Jesus. That's how you serve him. 2 Peter 1:7, and in your godliness, brotherly kindness, in your brother kindness, love. Love. And Jude 1:2, may mercy and peace and love, he says, be multiplied to you. And I skipped Ephesians. In the letter to the Ephesians, Apostle Paul prays for the church, for the believer. And I want to end here. Worship team, you can come up. And there's this prayer here in Ephesians 3. I don't know. Do I have that on? I do. He starts in verse 14, and here's his prayer. He says, for this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its names, that he would grant to you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with the power through the Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. Right? For what purpose? Just to know it? Just to know the love of Christ? Is that why he's praying? Just so that you might feel good about the love of Christ in your life? No, because the rest of Ephesians, Paul exhorts us over and over and over again, right? He exhorts us in every area of life, right? In Ephesians 4, he says, therefore, I, a prisoner of the Lord, right after this prayer, therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. And the rest of the letter hits us on the calling of our life to walk in a way of love in every area of our life. The rest of Ephesians talks about every area of our life, our marriages, our work, right? Our children. And it's all powered by understanding the height and depth and breadth of the love of God in us. Why? Because we are not able to then live a life towards every other area of our life in that great love unless we understand it in our life with Christ, the breadth and depth of that love in us, for us. And so the rest of Ephesians, right? The rest of Ephesians then lays it out. Now express this love. Express it in your marriage. Express it in your jobs. Express it. Express it, children, towards your parents, right? And vice versa. The prayer is personal. It's personal. So let's make it personal. Let's pray this. Lord God, right? For this reason, we bow our knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth derives its name, that he would grant us, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith, and that we, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled up to the fullness of God. And how will God answer this prayer? We don't have to guess. The very next verse. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. How are you going to love? The power of Christ that works within us, right? And who gets the glory? The very next verse. To him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. And all God's people say, amen.
Let's all stand together. We'll close the service with one last song of praise about the greatness of our Lord.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour.
Together, all the earth.
It's all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great I am, Lord.
All the earth.
It's all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Great I am, Lord.
All the earth.
All the earth.
your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Amen. Thank you guys so much for worshiping with us this morning. It's always great to be with you. We hope you have a great rest of your Sunday, and we look forward to seeing you back here next week. Make sure to check your bulletins for all the upcoming events. And as a reminder, the offering box is available in the back on your way up to the foyer. God bless. Have a great Sunday.